I can feel what's going on inside of a piece of electronic equipment. I have this sense that I know, and to some extent I have control over what's going on inside the transistors and inside the resistors. When I'm thinking about how to solve a particular problem, I can think about it for days and weeks and nothing will happen. And then, you know, someday when I'm cutting the grass or I'm having a hamburger or I wake up in the middle of the night, the idea will be there. I think it would be egotistical of me to say I thought of it. What happened is I opened my mind up and the idea came through me and into my head. These ideas, I don't have to dig up anything. Sometimes I don't even have to be thinking about them. And there they are. It's something between discovering and witnessing.
Greetings to all of you from me and the rest of us. Before I begin to show you the modular components that I'm going to send you, Herb, I thought I'd play a little bit on the Abominatron here. Of course, you can modulate the frequency with any of the signals. Most obvious one, of course, is sticking a little sine or triangular wave, low frequency, get a vibrato. Here's sawtooth modulation. Well, I'd appreciate your comments, what you think of the potential of a contraption like this is.
It wasn't natural. I think that was the first response. It wasn't natural, and therefore it wasn't right. It wasn't the way things should be. An interview I did at an Acoustical Society conference in Canada a couple of years after my equipment was introduced, what the media focused on were two things. The first was that U.S. Steel was introducing a soundproof garbage pail, and the second was that rock music was making musicians deaf. And those are the two big things. This, not the first, but the second question the interviewer asked me is, he leaned into the camera and he said, "Tell me, Mr. Moog, don't you feel guilty about what you've done?" Well, that upset me. I remember leaving that conference with my family and being so mad that I drove up on the sidewalk by accident. Back then, anything that didn't come out of wood or a brass instrument or from a string was considered somehow suspect at least, and downright harmful at best. People were very suspicious of electronic electronic instruments producing musical sounds. Before the release of Switched on Bach, which was the end of 1968, not much music had been made with electronic instruments. People heard lots of funny sounds. They heard the sounds in television and radio commercials. Perhaps they heard the sounds in experimental music, which was very, very strange to most people. But what Switched on Bach did was prove that you could make real music that had widespread appeal with these instruments. And I think that was the first really big shift in people's perception of synthesizer and the whole electronic music medium. Then, of course, when rock musicians like Keith Emerson and Rick Wakeman, Jan Hammer began playing, then suddenly it's clearly a human activity. And I think the idea that it was something dangerous and fake and nasty, that died away. It's very easy to these days to have an electronic instrument make a sound like wow type sound. Very popular. When these sorts of sounds were first being heard by the general public, people were freaking out. It was the same sort of reaction that we think of primitive cultures having, that a photographer might steal your spirit. And I guess that's what that interviewer at the Musical Society meant by feeling guilty. You know, that, you know, part of it is you're destroying music, you're destroying human culture as we know it today.
Solder on there. Okay, now we should get some sound. Try the key. Yeah, get an octave there.
I like to design an instrument that's as open and as wide range as possible, so that there are as many possibilities as possible. So each one of these controls here, for instance, you know, covers a very wide range. You can make rapid sounds, long sounds. You can play on a keyboard, you can play on the knobs, you can play on the touch surface. The quality of a musical sound is determined primarily by how the sound moves from beginning to end. Some sounds are very stable and others shimmer or build up and decay or vibrate in a variety of ways. And as a musician, you get to know which knob to reach for and turn when you want a certain kind of change. We began building synthesizer modules in 1964, and by the time we started doing the mini Moog, we had several years' experience with musicians using our modular equipment to produce all kinds of music. You name it. There was a record out, or there had been a live performance of a particular kind of music. So we knew that there were certain things that all musicians wanted to be able to do. They all gravitated to this sort of tone-producing capability here. Three oscillators, three wide-range oscillators. Everybody liked the filter and these sorts of controls. This particular type of envelope, where you shape individually the rising portion, the decaying portion, the sustain before you let go of the key and the release afterwards. This particular one was actually defined for us by Vladimir Usachevsky, who had years of experience before that making experimental music. But his definition, which this is an embodiment of, has become standard now in mainstream electronic musical instrument design. Wow. if this were a digital keyboard, in other words, if the sound were made digitally, what we would have in here would be one very large microprocessor, like a computer microprocessor, and one very large memory. And then all the sounds would be in a form of numbers in that memory. You press a key, those numbers would come out and be converted into sound waves. That's if this were a digital instrument, which is not. This is an analog instrument. So we have electronic components actually making the electrical vibrations. In the sound path of this, there are no numbers. They're all electrical vibrations, which are the analog of things like strings and wood and brass. So this big board here is where the sound is made. And appropriately enough, we call it the analog board. There's a lot of parts on here. There are over 800 parts. I have one over here that I can show you a little bit more closely. Each section of this board here corresponds to one section of the front panel. And these are called connectors here, bring in the electrical signals that tell the analog circuitry what pitch to go at, when to start a note and when to stop it, and so on. And these little blue adjustments here are the tuning adjustments. There are 21 or 22 of them on this board, and they all have to be set just right, as they would have to be in any musical instrument. When I think of this circuit, I have a feeling for what's happening with the electricity as it goes through these parts. You know, I don't imagine resistors being stretched out on a row like this, because that has nothing to do with the sound. What it has to do with is all these little traces on the board here that connect it together and cause the current to change as it goes from one part to the other. So I have a feeling which is very similar to how I imagine a violin maker feels when he's just getting the right amount of wood in one surface of the violin. There are a lot of people who begin to feel what the circuits do in a way that's similar to the way I feel them. Now, I have technical training, so I visualize things more in terms of voltages and currents, but you can also visualize them in terms of how the sound is changing. And I know for a fact that musicians make contact with this board inside the instrument here. Not physical contact. It's not like they have it under their armpits, but there's something going around here that connects what's going here with what's going inside here. It's not spiritual in the sense that it's religious, but it's spiritual in the sense that it uses some way of connecting what's in the things that are in the universe by ways other than directly with ours that we can see with our senses. Here's a sweet pepper. This one is turning from yellow to red. And here's another sweet pepper, a completely different kind, turning from green to red. I've always liked gardening, even as a small child, and my father did too. He was an engineer. Gardening, of course, puts you in touch with nature. Growing things requires that you get in tune with nature. What all this has to do with inventing, I'm not quite sure. But somehow they all feel like the same thing to me. Both my wife and I have the view of our universe, of the environment we're in here, as a very complex ecosystem that has to be taken care of, just like a finely tuned machine. This is an organic garden here. We grow our own food. We know exactly what nutrients we put in the soil and what poisons we don't put in the soil. So we feel that we're controlling our own personal environment, our own personal ecology, by having the garden. The plants were kind of scraggly. If we sprayed them, they wouldn't look quite so scraggly, but they grow. You see that one leaf dies here and then another one grows in its place. Meantime, the tomatoes come and they're very good. Very good. This is a pepper plant. This is a nice hot pepper. And these are basil plants here. We like cooking with fresh herbs. These are collard greens. They're pretty badly eaten. Our pet chickens ate most of them. So we grow food for them as well as for us. And whatever they don't eat, we eat.
What happened to your pet chickens?
Well, their place on Earth was terminated very suddenly yesterday when a couple of stray dogs came on the land here and helped themselves to the chickens. So now the collards will grow back and we'll have to eat them all. In retrospect, it looks like it was meant to happen. I was building and selling theremin kits. Because of that, I met Herb Deutsch, who was a musician using the theremin in his music classes. Because we met, he invited me to his concert. Because I went to his concert, I learned about electronic music. Because Herb and I got together and talked about making electronic music, I got some ideas for the synthesizer. Because I got some ideas for the synthesizer, we built the equipment. We showed it to one person who then told an official of the Audio Engineering Society about it, and I was invited to display the equipment. And my favorite way of saying it is that I got into the electronic musical instrument business like slipping backwards on a banana peel. It was just, you know, one easy thing after another, and there I was. And it looks like a logical progression today, but back then it was, well, you know, if I do this, then let's see what happens.
Okay, if you have a mini Moog, if you haven't done this before, you wasted a lot of your life. This is one of the funnest things ever to do with a mini Moog. So you might be leaving early before we even stop and get home and disturb your neighbors.
My favorite knob to grab was the cutoff frequency.
Yeah.
Now you say there's a pedal.
Yeah, not here, but there's a place to put a pedal on the back, yeah.
That was my favorite because I can do this. But if we get that other sound, that's a noise, right? We're actually getting that real percussive sound, too. What was that at? And it was modulating as well.
Okay, my little modulation. There we go.
There. Oh, now we're going to some space sound.
Everybody knows that's what aliens sound like.
Yeah, that's right. You created the whole language of alien alien alphabet or whatever. And it would slow down. You slow it down. I would go. We're descending. The spaceship's landing now.
This is a duet here.
Then little aliens came.
Everybody giving a demonstration of the new Moog synthesizer. People would say, what the hell's a synthesizer? The word wasn't even known.
Yeah, things were changing so fast that I never got a bead on exactly who was who this equipment was for. First it was for the experimental musician, then it was for a few people in New York City who had some crazy ideas about new sounds to make. And then it was more people in New York who were making advertising commercials, and then it was the album producers, and this was constantly changing. And of course, I didn't have any experience at all, anyhow. Making payroll was a challenge, but keeping up with these this changing market conditions really drove us nuts.
You know, I was running around trying to figure out who to sell these things to, because they were quite expensive. I mean, you could buy a nice house and a nice car for what these cost back in those days.
Well, there was a lot of work in them.
There certainly was.
These are all handmade.
Yes, and they also weren't being sold by the dozen. They were being sold one at a time, and each sale required many, many hours of work on my part.
Yes.
They didn't know what it was, and you had to teach them the concept of how the thing was able to do the marvelous things that it could do.
Yeah. Who were the first people here in New York who bought modular systems? Yeah.
They were mainly the music houses, the people that supplied music for commercials.
Yeah.
And of course, they saw it, unfortunately, as a means of replacing musicians. I said, look, this is the first time there's an instrument where you can produce a totally sound that's never been heard before. They were very heady days because we knew that this was something that was really going to have an influence on music.
But a lot of uh, a lot of the music producers did wind up making a lot of commercials, didn't they? Oh, I remember there was Dick Lasky and Mimorsky, Zimmerman and Ham.
Oh, yes.
And that was Ed Kalehoff.
Of course. Ed was one of the more proficient performers on the instrument.
A synthesizer is nothing but a new step in the evolution of musical instruments. To call it a machine, we would call in every other instrument a machine too. We could call a piano a machine, because have you ever seen a piano on the side of the lever? It's a very complicated mechanism.
The thing is too, I love this here. Great life, four books.
Was this from the concert too?
I remember when I worked with Jean-Jacques Perry in the beginning, he used his ondioline,
yeah.
And I played a clavichord. Old one. But I felt always very frustrated because he had an electronic instrument and I just did some, you know, that blah, 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 blah. And one day came the guy who did that famous commercial for
Eric Sade. Yeah.
And he introduced me to a box like this, looked like a telephone switch. I said, what is this? And he brought me this sound. I said, oh my God.
Eric Sade showed you that?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
I have to have that. I said, Eric, what? From Robert Moog. Who is he? No, he's a kind of a crazy engineer who does all these weird instruments, who lives up in a little hamlet in North State of New York, Trumansburg. So of course I called you up, and yeah. I came there, and in his basement, I remember only it was very wet, and I mean, horrible. I became so sick, and there he was bustling on the modules of the Moog synthesizer, right? And the first Moog was still in a very wooden box.
Yeah.
Usually they use this wood to put coffins in, you know, but anyway, by the way, this box is now at the Smithsonian.
No.
Yes. That box is the Smithsonian now. I sold it to my neighbor on 55th Street,
yeah.
I forgot his name again, and he gave it into the Smithsonian.
Yeah.
You know. Listen, those things would be very valuable today, you know.
I remember, you know, sitting, I was right in the middle of the orchestra. My parents were there and my Aunt Dorothy was there. You know,
that was actually the first time the Moog performed live in a concert, or not?
It was for sure the first time four Moog performed
live. Of course, Keith Emerson and other people played always in Prague, but yeah. Four Moog.
Oh, this was before that.
Yes.
It was way before. You know, nobody had ever done anything like that. I was holding my breath because I wanted everything to work, you know.
It seemed to work.
everybody takes it for granted today that electronic equipment will always work. You know, somehow, you know, the state of the art has advanced.
Listen,
back then it was...
The problem was you worked it during the... You got the boxes, and it went always out of tune. We had to retune it.
Well, you know, the first musicians I ever worked with on the synthesizer weren't interested in melodies. They were interested in new sounds. All they wanted to do was to be able to make new sounds.
Yeah.
So they didn't care about tuning. And then we added a keyboard, and it wouldn't stay in tune because we didn't worry about it. And then all of a sudden, everybody wanted to play melodies because it was part of pop music.
Actually, every Moog can be built differently. It depends on your own requirements. So it's not actually one instrument. You can build it up the way you want. It's like an erector set, you see?
When I began doing stuff for electronic musicians, I built modules. And each module was a little box with an input and an output that did one thing and one thing only, to either making a waveform, sound waveform, or modifying it somehow, or making a shape that the waveform would change by. And you could connect these together with cables, with patch cords. So that's how we began. And by the time 2 or 3 years went by, this was around 1967, we had a whole system of these things. We could put them all in a box and connect them together. So we thought of the process of making the sounds as putting the parts together, which is what synthesize means, to put together a whole, something whole out of all of its parts. And that's when we decided to use the word synthesizer. And in fact, in our 1967 catalog of Moog Music, we had a little section called The Synthesizer Concept, and we explained what we meant by the use of the word synthesizer. We didn't mean to imply that what it made were synthetic sounds. They were synthesized sounds. They weren't fake anything. They were real synthesized sounds.
That's such a great idea, because I mean, I think about early computer culture. You remember one of those most famous images we have of all the early computers was flowcharts, you know, like, you know, this, if so, then do this, and you have these little line and like a little box and a triangle, you know, stuff like that. But those were like logic charts, you know, being able to have trace the flow of information through a very specific system. And that's basically what I hear you talking about that.
Yeah.
But for me, sampling was a way of playing with systems of memory and being able to remember a record from 1972, take the bass line from that, splice it, you know, into like, you know, a record from 1995, you know, take a horn riff from a 1922 record, you know, a drum solo from 1960, whatever, and mix it up. So I was synthesizing found sounds, pulling them all together, and being able to have, again, like the real sound, but edited and spliced and diced in the same way, but without, you know, the tones would come from the collage of all the different sounds running.
Yeah.
So I would, you know, I would just have to type on the keyboard and use a mouse to navigate. But the cool thing is what I'm hearing you is you're navigating about the idea of pitch envelopes and stuff like that. It's much more, in a certain sense, you know the composer Yannis Xenakis' work?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Between him and playing with Sun Ra, it was kind of interesting to see. One guy was super classical music, the other guy was free jazz. And the Sun Ra Orchestra, you know, I view their take on what you're talking about is they would apply this idea of myth science to it, like being able to almost have the tones and the way you're talking about the oscillators and the filter patches and the chords. But your pitch envelopes and everything could also make drum machines.
That's right.
Yeah, so you'd be able to take a really thick bass tone, for example, and have that be the bass drum.
Yeah,
or the snare drum, like, you know, stuff like that.
Once you had the envelope, And if it were controlling pitching, it could control anything. It could make it the sound louder and softer. It could make it brighter and darker. It could change the whole sound from one thing to another on the same contour. And that was one of the, you know, one of the really important concepts behind the synthesizer.
So you could say that you're almost an inventor of a certain style of drum machine too, right? I mean, that's another big deal with hip hop right now, is the whole programming of beats.
My first encounters with Bob came off, didn't they? It came after I actually discovered the Moog. There was a studio in England called Advision Studios, and a guy called Mike Vickers had bought one of the big modular systems. And he couldn't afford to pay for it. So what he did, he left it in the studio, so because he knew that when keyboard players came in and saw it, they'd go, oh, great, can we have a go? And then the guy there would say, yeah, but it's going to cost you $50 to have a go on it. And that was how, you know, we made a lot of money. And we used it a lot, and it was fantastic. And then I discovered the Mini Moog.
Yeah.
I don't know whether you know the very first story of how I bought my first Mini Moog.
How was that?
Now, well, the manager that we had at the time, it was a bit of a villain. He said, I've got an actor.
Yeah.
He said, who works for me. And I'll tell you, well, the actor called Jack Wilde. He played, I can't remember what the doctor, he was in Summit anyway. And he bought a Mini Moog. And Brian said, he wants to sell it. I said, oh, yeah. And he said, he'll do you a really good deal because it doesn't work. And I said, what do you mean it doesn't work? He said, it doesn't work. He said, he'll do you a really, really good deal, like half price what he paid for it. And I said, all right, okay, well, I'll have a look at it. And there wasn't anybody who fixed them or anything there. So it arrived, and it was mint. It was all in all the original, because they used to come in the original, like, plastic, all the big, thick oil and things. And I took it out, and I plugged it in, expecting smoke or something, and it all lit up right, and put the headphones in, put them on. And it was like never been played. It was absolutely perfect. It was absolutely fantastic. Yeah. This is not a joke, but it's absolutely true. So I thought, well, I better be honest here, because I left it on soak all night, still fantastic. And I phoned up Brian, the manager, and I said, look, it's minimum. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. He said, well, I don't understand. He said, I'll get the guy on the phone. So he got the actor on the phone, and I spoke to him, and he said, I said, listen, I've got to tell you, there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. He said, no, he said, I've tried it a lot. He said, I can only get it to play one note at a time.
Yeah.
And I said, it's monophonic, it only plays one note at a time. He said, well, that's no good to me. He said, oh, you can have it. So I bought it for half price, and that was the first one. And then I went out, and over the course of the next 2 years, I bought another eight. So I ended up...
You needed more than one load at a time.
Oh, they were that's right. Well, they were fantastic. I used to use four on stage for yes, and then four around. And I think the Mini Moog is... Because I had the was it the P model, the one that was the modular one?
Yeah.
I had that, but for on stage, there has never been anything surpassed it. I mean, it changed the face of music. Absolutely changed. I mean, for the first time, I mean, we were talking on the radio station the other day when you could, for the first time in your life as a keyboard player, you could go on and give the guitarists a run for their money. Because before, the guitarists were always nice and loud. Oh, here comes a keyboard solo. You know, really quiet, everybody going. Yeah. But suddenly you had something that was louder than them, would cut through concrete.
Good, man. I mean, when you saw guitar players, they hated it. When he's the keyboard player, oh, shit, he's got a Mini Moog. Yeah. So they're looking for 11 on the volume control. It's the only way they can compete. And there's, you know, nobody's ever come up with anything like ever like the Mini Moog, and they won't. To me, that's the most important keyboard instrument that's ever been made. I'm not saying that because you stand there, but it is. It's the most important one that's ever been made, because it changed the face of music for people. It was absolutely fantastic, and I bow before you forever for that moment. There's not one knob on there or switch that you don't use.
Yeah.
That's not just taking up space.
it does something. It has a function.
Everything. Yes. And yet, how many things are made today that you've got? Probably you don't use 90% of what's on them. I mean, it's a bit like your wife, isn't it, really? You know, you only use 10% of your of what you need, and then the other 90% is superfluous to needs, really. But, you know, okay. It's probably why I've been married so many times. but the
Come on, man, you're killing me, man.
Sexual mind. How I play, how I tell everybody, male or female, especially the females, I play sexual because it's foreplay, climax, and then down after. So it's a sexual thing with me. And so the touch of the mini moog is like a female to me. So I play kind of knobs, playing. I have sonata that have different screams, different whoos, or different. Different the bottom,
yeah.
And touching it and playing it, and yeah. Thank you very much.
I used to think like that. I used to think of it sexually with the foreplay and the climate, but unfortunately, I found that my solos were very short when I did. I had to stop thinking like that.
You can play it rhythmically and chapo all night long. Trial and error, and he experimented, just like we experiment when we're playing. I think. I don't want to talk out of line.
He just came up with an instrument that could make sounds that nobody else could. Absolutely nobody's ever come close. And it's come from the inside of this man. It's come from this man's heart, and he's given it to us.
I'll tell you where I think it comes from. I think it comes from out there, you know, and it comes through me into the instrument, and then the music comes through you guys in the instrument. And that out.
We're all being tapped. Yeah. It's all given to us as an inventor, musician, composer, songwriter, through the one. Believing that it all comes from there. It's coming through y'all, through the camera.
Bob's given us an instrument with an X factor. And if you try to find out what the X factor is, you're wasting your time. Just be thankful it's there.
Yeah.
It's a great thing.
Yeah.
Remember when we finally got together and I had built up some couple of voltage control oscillators?
Oh yeah.
Looking back, how did that, well, that strike you?
That was one of the most exciting times in my life. To be able to sit there and be within fingertip control of what were really new sounds at that time.
When you took these circuits and your tape recorder down into the basement and you actually put music together, that blew my mind. You know, that it sounded one way, it sounded very electronic and striking, but not musical on the bench. But then when you assembled sounds musically on the tape, all of a sudden it became a piece of music. That was totally amazing.
You know, it, the thing about electronic instruments is that as soon as you touch them, if you're a musician, they immediately trigger off musical ideas, because the reference point is there. I mean, there is a reference point of a world of music you know, and then there is the other reference point, was the is that music that potentially would be there, the music that could grow out of sounds that that the traditional instruments can't make and that the traditional references aren't there for. We talked, for instance, about, at the very beginning days, about whether the instrument should have a keyboard.
That's right.
In the very first few days, should it have a keyboard? Is that necessary?
Yeah, there were all sorts of ways of shaping the pitch of the sound. Yeah. Keyboard was just one of them.
Yeah.
And in fact, I remember thinking that this keyboard is not necessarily for changing pitch. It could change anything. It could change loudness. It could change vibrato. It could change the tone color. Anything.
And eventually, of course, it got to that level.
Yeah.
And I remember feeling that a keyboard would make sense. And I know that Vladimir Ussachevsky had said, you and he had spoken, and he had said that the keyboard may not be a good idea because it would force people to think very traditionally.
In a way, he was afraid of how people's keyboard technique would come through on material that really shouldn't be organized according to pitch.
And, you know, looking at it retrospectively now, it's 40 years later, Bob.
Yeah.
He was partially right.
Yeah.
Because a great deal of the material that was generated by synthesizers since then has been material which could very well have been generated without synthesizers. And, you know, in thinking that way, Vladimir was right.
Yeah.
But of course, what I don't think either of us realized was how much that would change the whole nature of thinking about what keyboard-controlled sounds could be.
It's interesting to me the steps in the evolution, you know, when you and I first worked together, because of your influence on me, I thought that what we were doing together was figuring out ways to make new kinds of sounds, so that these sounds could then be combined on a tape recorder and sequenced to make interesting sound sequences. From that, the people who made music for commercial music for radio and TV began to use the same equipment to make evocative sounds for commercials. And because the general public got used to those sounds, the next step was using them for melodic purposes.
Yes, yes.
So it's as if what we began got diverted or deflected into the mainstream, and then when it came back, it was suddenly all tonal and keyboard oriented. It was in 1970 that I visited our dealer in London. He said, I'd like to introduce you to a young musician who just bought one of your modular systems. And he took me to an apartment nearby, introduced me to Keith Emerson.
Yeah.
As I remember, we had tea. Do you believe that?
Yeah.
maybe I'm making that up. But Keith did give me a test pressing. It turned out to be Lucky Man. And I thought to myself, woo-hoo. And you know, Keith explained that you know, this was one of the first things he had done with the synthesizer. First time I saw Keith live was at the Gaelic Park. And then I knew for sure that he was a musician who was going to revolutionize pop music through his incredibly creative and virtuosic use of our synthesizer stuff. I think this is a good time for me to stop talking. Yes. Class?
Ladies and gentlemen, Keith Emerson.
Eventually, in another year, every little boy will ask his father and mother, can I have a synthesizer, a mini Moog for Hanukkah or for Christmas?
One thing, this may sound weird, but one thing we found is that there are things going on that are not part of the physical world that we don't know how to describe now. You can communicate with a computer or a musical instrument or a car with your mind without touching anything. I'm doing several things while I'm in Japan here. First is, I gave a talk at the Visualog graphic design conference in Nagoya just a few days ago. Graphic designers from all over the world came to talk about things that they were interested in. I had an audience of about 3,000 people. Some of them were students, some of them were people from around the world who make a living doing graphic design. I talked about the interactive properties of musical instruments, not just electronic musical instruments, but musical instruments in general. And that's part of the designer's interest in interaction. Interaction is a very hot topic these days. Design is seen as not just something static, but something that becomes a part of the observer. And there's a communication going back and forth. Some of the communication we understand, some of it, frankly, we don't understand. For instance, why do you feel at one with your musical instrument? why do you feel the instrument is an extension of your hands? There's something going on that's more than just the way the instrument feels and sounds. And we don't really know what that is, but we're beginning to learn. And then yesterday afternoon, I gave a talk at a very large musical instrument store in the Akihabara section. It's called La Ox, and very big. And they had organized a talk show, they called it, for me to give. There were 30 musicians there. And what amazed me, there was a great variety of musicians, but among them in the room were four thereminists, four good thereminists. They were all young women, and they were all very seriously studying the theremin as a musical instrument. So the theremin is fairly new to Japan, but in the short time that people here have known about it, it's about 2 or 3 years, several musicians, maybe more than I know, have taken up the instrument seriously and have studied it with the idea of becoming professional thereminists. I built my first theremin when I was 14, and I was absolutely obsessed with building and later designing theremins for all through high school. And the first instrument I ever made for money was a theremin. It was 1954. At this point, I guess I'm as well known as anybody is for building theremins. So theremins have been a thread through my musical instrument designing life. I love the theremin as a technical phenomenon because it's very simple. It does so much, and it's such a sensitive musical instrument. Simplicity, elegance too, and that pleases my engineering aesthetic, that you can get a lot of functionality and a lot of sensitivity out of just a few parts. What's been happening over the last several decades is that music is becoming more and more something that producers do by themselves for listeners who listen by themselves. Whereas if you go back, say before electronics, music is always something that was done by musicians and listeners being together and interacting. I think that kind of interaction is the most important aspect of music, culturally.
Thank you.
The instruments that we design are all performance instruments. They're for people to play live, because that's, you know, to me, that's the most basic sort of music. The sort of music where you work with computers and you work with tape recorders and combine stuff in the privacy of your own studio is an emulation of live performance. And I just hope we don't forget that the studio produced music and all the recorded music that's an important part of our life will remain important, I think. But I just don't. I hope we don't forget how important it is for live performance, where musicians interact with players and form a community right there on the spot. My wife, Ileana Grams, is a retired philosopher. Her specialty, one of her specialties, is in the philosophy of religion. We do a lot of talking at home about the nature of religion and spirituality. We're both learning a lot about the nature of reality and the connections we have with realities that are at a different level than what we experience every day here in the material world. And I think that's changed the way I think about instruments too. The more you get into material, into matter, the more you realize that all there is in matter is energy. There's a blur between energy and consciousness. All material is conscious to some extent or another. All material can respond to some extent or another to the vibrations of energy that is different from the energy you learn about in physics. There's all sorts of reliable information now on people and animal being able to affect the operations of machines, even of computers. And I think that has great implications for what goes on between a musician and his instrument. There is a level of reality where there is no time and there is no space. There's just energy. And we have contact with that through the intermediate layers. So if the right channels, if the right connections are established, I don't see why a piece of matter, a piece of broken glass or an old record can't make contact through this very high level of reality that has access to everything past and future. I suppose my instruments do retain some sort of a memory of me. I know that when I'm working on them, I feel, not explicitly, I don't hear voices in my head or anything. But I have this feeling that I'm making a connection with them. The circuit diagram that is then converted into a circuit board, which then becomes a part of an instrument, is something that, is a record that I made. So I guess, in that sense, it's certainly a memory.
Thank you.